Amen. Well, good morning. I love to see how full we are this morning. I love how Steve angled the seats in. Everything about it just seems pretty cool this morning. So really blessed to get the opportunity to lead worship. And I wanted to open up by telling you a small story. I was voluntold to go to a concert this weekend, and I don't like big, flashy concerts. That's not really my place to be. And I'll just be really upfront. I was uncomfortable the whole time, but as I looked around, I was watching people who were very comfortable worshiping God. And the inspiration came from seeing them worshiping in an environment that I was uncomfortable in. And it just reminds me so much that worship doesn't come from the outside. It doesn't come from the kind of music you like or from just the kind of style that you like. Or the situation you like, it comes from the inside of us. And in every one of our hearts rings a melody. And it's within us to choose whether or not we're going to worship in those moments, even when we're uncomfortable. So let's uncomfortably stand together, and we're going to sing, "In My Heart There Rings a Melody." Dead pedal.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory, with the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony, when the courts of heaven. A melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love.
Amen. Got your clappers ready? This is one of those songs you kind of have to clap along with.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white, pure and white in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside your garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Now you are in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Now you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Heavenly Father God, we just thank you so much that you provided us that Lamb, your only Son, God. Father, that he died in our place, that he took our sin from us so that we can be clean, we can be free, Father God. And we just receive that gift of grace so willfully, so open, Father. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord God. In your name. Amen. We're going to introduce you a new one this morning that I'm pretty certain you guys are going to appreciate and going to like. But if it's unfamiliar and you want to listen, don't feel obligated to sing along. But once you get the chorus down, I think you're going to want to sing with us again. So,
this world is not my home. I'm here but for a moment. It's all I've ever known, but this world is not my home. The fight is not my home. These burdens are my future. The empty tomb has shown, and I am bound for glory.
Are you bound?
I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory. The saving work is done, and death is not my ending. My God has overcome. I am bound for glory. And I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory.
Let's do that again, shall we?
I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory. And all my pain and hurt and shame gone when Jesus calls my name. Endless joy, endless praise. Jesus calls my name. All my pain and hurt and shame gone when Jesus calls my name. Endless joy, endless praise. Oh, when Jesus calls my name. I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory. my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory. Where my feet will stand on holy ground, I am bound for glory.
Amen, amen. You may be seated.
Testing, there we go. Who would have expected that when we came into this little sleepy town of Weiser that's into fiddles and all this type of stuff, that we would make our mark not only with this church, but also my son and his family. Well, my son married a Weiserite. And so now we have a couple of grandkids here. So, I mean, it's been like 7 years since we first came out. And I had met my son's wife in the youth group that was a part of this church. And man, it just keeps going on and on. And I'm just like, I'm never going to get out of this town. You know, you keep coming back and visiting. I mean, it was funny pulling into this town, honestly. So I'm from Seattle. So I'm a city kid. And here I am, come pulling into this town. I'm like looking, going, what's out here? Where? Oh, my goodness. And then, but pulling in, it's, honestly, we fall in love with this town. You guys are absolutely amazing. I've said this many times. I've never met a more giving and serving community. From whether it's coach in schools, to the pastors here, to the people that are part of different ministries, and just not only worldwide, but also here. In your own community. Because here's what I believe as a missionary that's been traveling to 16 countries, 4 continents, and doing this, doing this 17 years, the crazy thing is, I know that if we're not serving God in our own communities, then we shouldn't be going across to Africa and other places around the world. Amen? It really starts with our passion happening here within our own communities. And that's what happened with my wife and I. And you know, we met in high school, and now, if you want to go ahead and put it up there, our family has grown. We have three children, 2 daughters and a son. We have 5 granddaughters. Yeah, a lot of estrogen, for sure. And 1 grandson, he's the one that's here. Do you want to go? Let's see, the next. Oh, that's why my wife is not here. This is my oldest daughter, Bree, and she is ready to pop. I mean, like any day. And she got really upset when she heard that she was going to come be here and not be there just in case our other grandson comes here. So it's literally, she's just before coming here, we had to rush to the hospital. I mean, we've been going and going, and because this little boy really wants to come, but also he wants to stay. So trying to figure it out. So my wife is back there. We haven't heard anything, have we? All right, good. So right now he's still cooking, growing. But I'm telling you, it's just, I just keep seeing this kid just push. And women, you guys are so amazing. So amazing. It pains me. And the doctor said, this boy is going to be a handful. Because he just keeps, I mean, looked like an alien sitting there pushing. And my daughter's going, oh. And whenever I talk to him, my daughter hates it because he just starts going crazy. So anyway, I cannot wait to meet him. So our growing family, but I think more than anything, how many of you guys have heard or not heard of Orphan Relief and Rescue? I just want to see in the room. Just one. Not heard about us. All right, some. So I'm just, because I want to get a quick update to you guys what we do and how we do this so you guys can understand. We have Pastor Steve and many families in this church that sponsor Orphan Relief and Rescue. My wife and I founded Orphan Relief and Rescue about 12 years ago. We work in, oh, this is little Kai. Oh, buddy. He's back there sleeping, I think, isn't he? Yeah. All right, could go to the next slide here. We work in Liberia and Benin, West Africa. We were working for an organization called Mercy Ships, and they were doing free surgeries on the west coast of Africa. That's how we got there, because there's 54 nations on the continent of Africa. And with 54 heads of state, it's just pretty crazy. So why did we go, how did we find that? Well, because I was renovations manager on the ship. And it was a floating hospital, and I took care of, with a whole bunch of master carpenters under me, we took care of the ship to keep it operating. It was a hospital ship that did free surgeries. It was amazing to be able to do that and have the opportunity. But that's where we found these little nations. Liberia is known as one of the poorest nations in the world still today. And Benin is the main child trafficking route of the whole continent of Africa, where they sell kids and they do some of the most awful things. And so we found ourselves placed in this place 12 years ago, and it's continued to grow. And so I just wanted to show a video here, an introduction of what we do, because it's better for you to see it, and then we can talk some more.
Together we can do beautiful things.
And I love that, together we can do beautiful things. Two things that really impact me whenever I stand here in front of my church families. We have churches all over the United States that are helping Orphan Relief and Rescue, and you being one of them, and one of the first churches, is that we cannot do this without you. One thing is, we in Benin, West Africa, it is the birthplace of voodoo. And as many of you know, like New Orleans and Haiti and stuff like that, that is where they've really formed just this practice of doing such harm to children. And you guys, we go over there and we're cursed to die. Awful things happen, but what we do know is, with church families like this, we know that you guys pray for us. And I can't thank you enough for the many times. I didn't expect doing this 12 years. I thought after leaving Mercy Ships, we were just going to move on. But I couldn't stop. I couldn't stop thinking about these kids that we saw suffering. And I really believe that this is a calling of God. But it takes everyone working together to do this. And so I want to thank you for that. And then also for you guys that have been very generous in your giving. Again, we can't do this without you. And so I'm going to touch on just a few of our programs just very quickly and show you some of the exciting things that are happening. Because, again, for Rebecca and I to both do this, we have employees in both countries. In Benin, we employ pastors that are anti-trafficking team members that go out in the village, carrying the very presence of Jesus Christ to be able to share the message of the gospel in some of the darkest places, where they actually, most of the families, have killed their firstborn child to instill a blessing on the rest of their children. Those practices, though, through faithfulness and through our Lord Jesus Christ, have stopped in 5 of the main trafficking villages. And that is what is so exciting. Greater is he that is in us, isn't it true, than he that is in this world, no matter what is going on. And that's my encouragement to you. I hope today, as we're sharing with this, that you guys understand in the 30 minutes I have to share with you, that you are encouraged about our faith in stepping out to do this in Africa, but encourage you in your faith here. So one of them is, go to the next slide, Nicole, please, is a Break the Silence. That is in Liberia, has become a tier one risk for trafficking of children. This country means that it's one of the top countries where children are at risk, that just even to have a pencil, to ask for a pencil if they don't have it, that they're asked to give sexual favors to the teachers and other things like that. And the thing is, they didn't know that that wasn't the thing to do. You have orphans, more orphans in this country. You have, after 14 years of civil war, you have more young children than adults. So 60% of this nation is 19 years of age and under. They wiped off the face of the earth, the older generation, through child soldiers. So many of them have done such awful things. But it's helping them to be able to see that they are valuable. Their body is their own, and they have rights. And we're seeing that change there's a hotline within the government that we are able to fund, thank the Lord, to be able to provide safety for them to call and say, hey, we're being hurt, and then send out people to be able to check and to investigate. That's going really well. Go to the next slide, please. And the next one, the cool thing is, we are going to be, as a smaller organization, reach 15,000 children this year. And that is going to schools and being able to share this hotline number. We're going to be doing billboards within the country so that people can actually see that abusing children is not okay. The next slide, please. Microfinance in Benin. What's so interesting is when we first got there, we found that women were selling their children. 20%, as you heard on the video, are already, when you arrived, had been sold. We are working to be able to get many of those children back, finding out where they are, where they were sold, doing investigations. But what is so amazing is seeing the change of the culture. And the way we did that was a microfinance program. Started off with $4, and now over the years, we've had almost 98% payback to these loans. And each community has its own co-op. And so you guys, they're all doing it themselves. That's the amazing thing. We want to work ourselves out of a job. We're not doing this to be the great big white that's going over there to try to rescue people and not understand the culture. But we're also sharing about a God of love to them, recognizing that they are valuable themselves as well. And we're seeing many of them come to know Jesus Christ. Even witch doctors, even women that are coming and wanting to curse the people. It's crazy what we see over there. But that's happening. I want you to watch this video of one lady that has had, I think, 3 or 4 loans now.
First of all, I was really suffering because I have no activities. Somebody talks about
Is it not there? Is it on another screen? All right. Hey, Kip. No, that's the young lady. So microfinance ladies. Don't we love technology? Have an iPad, an iPhone, and all this type of stuff, and it gives them more grief than anything. Doesn't it, right? And it's crazy in the villages there, actually, because of William Buffett and Bill Gates, they actually have internet even in these remote villages. It's pretty crazy. The problem is, what we're finding is that traffickers are able to find these people through location services. So it's actually, if they get up to speed, it's causing more problems. Kids are using Facebook and all these other type things.
First of all, I was really suffering because I have no activities.
Oh, it is? Okay. Then go ahead and... Sorry, guys. That's okay. Just go ahead and turn it off. No, that's okay. The microfinance program is one of the most successful programs. We're able to put them into a feeding program for the children to go to school. And so we actually feed them at school two meals a day. So it allows them to be able to go there, because many of the kids were going home in the mornings and not coming back because they were so hungry. And many of them have to travel miles to come to school. So we did that. We give them a microfinance, and they make a commitment to the leaders of the village and through signed documents saying that they will not sell their children. We're also have been able to bring back girls from being trafficked, where they have been used and abused, and they have been so broken that we have a safe home for girls. And that's the next slide, and I want you to watch this video of one of the girls that we rescued. I think. It should be number 3. And you had that one up last time. There we go. So we have girls in these safe homes. If we can find them a place to be able to be in foster care, we will. But many times, because of the severe abuse, we actually have them in a safe home, and we have monitors and counselors that are able to pray with these girls to be able to help restore their dignity and their lives. And then we provide opportunities for them to do work and earn a living. So many of actually, at our event in Seattle, we have a big gala, and where hundreds of people come and see what we're doing and give to that. And they were able to do a whole bunch of different tablecloths and all this type of stuff. And so really we're seeing a lot of these girls really being restored. And you know, it's interesting, as we talk about Orphan Relief and Rescue, I don't want to just come and share what we do and ask you to give money or to pray for us. A lot of it is, you guys are a church family. And some of the things that I have been learning over the years, I wanted to take just the last 10, 15 minutes to be able to share with you something and a reminder. Because the one thing I know about this farming community is that you guys understand risk. You guys understand somewhat of pain as it pertains to a lot of your farming. And the things that you guys do, you guys rely on the weather, you rely on, you know, for your crops and everything to grow well and all this type of stuff. It's not easy, is it? And so many times we go through difficult times. The one thing I know in going over to these countries and over the last 12 years, my faith has been being built. And you know where it's been built from, where I see Jesus more clearly? Is through the kids and the families that we serve. There's one word I want you guys to hear this morning as a reminder of the body of Christ that each one of you as Christians have chosen to be. Because we're in the United States right now at a very interesting place, probably one of the most polarized times in recent history. And it's almost to be a Christian is uncool, is hateful. We're called that we're haters. It's just a whole bunch of just craziness. And you ask the questions, how can that be? There's always a story from someone, a loved one, someone that's just saying, oh, the Christian hurt me, I just don't believe in God anymore. But the one word I want to share about today is redemption. If you go to that slide, Nicole. Redemption defined as freedom from guilt or blame for having done something wrong. It's really actually, to be honest with you, a lame definition, but I looked all over and that's what Webster said. But what I love is the words that go along with that: grace, rebirth, restoration, forgiveness, acquittal, exoneration, and other rebirth. I love that. The one thing I have learned about these children, many of them, some of them were child soldiers, had to kill their own parents, and then were used in such awful ways to pick up a gun for wars, and then to kill the people, and then to take and to eat their body parts, because that was what was called to give them strength. But those are the kids that have been reborn, that I see Jesus in their lives now. I want to remind us that what Jesus did on the cross in Ephesians chapter 7, I want to read that for us. I'm going to read it in two translations. It's 7 through 10. In the New King James Version, it says, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he has made to abound towards us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mysteries of his will according to his good pleasure, which he has purposed in himself." In the Message, I think I like how it sums it up. Because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, our Messiah, his blood poured out on the altar of the cross, we're a free people, free from penalties, punishments chalked up by our own misdeeds. And not just barely free, abundantly free. He thought of everything, provided for everything we could possibly need, letting us in on the plans he took such delight in making. He set us free, all before us in Christ, a long-range plan in which everything was brought together and summed up in him. Everything in deepest heaven, everything on planet Earth. Now, my wife and I, in 12 years, I would love to say as missionaries, it's been a cakewalk. It's been just so easy. I know Steve has walked through some personal, very hard issues with his health. And I think what we do naturally is we say, I know I do, I don't know if Steve does, but my thing is, God, what did I do wrong? Isn't that what we do? Something happens to our families, something goes wrong, and immediately we go to that point. God, what did I do wrong? What we forget is what Christ did on the cross immediately when we say that. I want to remind us, I don't know what you guys are going through, but I know my wife and I have gone through what, for us, going to hell and back. Not only with our family, but with many other things that have happened in missions. It's almost like you think that if you're going to mission work, you're supposed to be super blessed because you're doing God's work. Come on. Pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is to visit orphans and widows in their troubles. God, you said that. Why am I having such a hard time? God, what did I do wrong? Wrong question, you guys. And you know where I learned that that was the wrong question? Not just through what the Bible says, but it's through these kids that have done some of the worst and awful things imaginable. But none of them, not one of them have I ever met out of the thousands that we have met, have ever said that. In fact, when I'm going through a hard time and I'm over there, maybe crying, these boys come over to me. One of them was 16 years old, and he climbed into my lap. And he placed his head on my chest, and through translation, I found out that he said, I just feel so, do not be sad, Father Tim, please. And through translation, he was saying, I just feel so safe when I hear your heartbeat. And immediately I remember why God said in the Bible, let's get back to becoming like little children. Children don't make so much of things. I'm 53 years old. I've lived a pretty long life, 31 years of marriage. But through those pressures and times they build up, it starts to tear at our own faith. And I will say that my faith has been tested in huge ways. But if I could remember the redemption, the beautiful thing about serving these kids is that I see Jesus and I remember who he is through these kids that we serve. It's such a beautiful thing to be able to recognize that. Go to the next slide, please. The other thing that I've learned and I want to leave with you today is this. And I'll just say this. It's interesting because I was reading an article on Florida oranges, that Florida oranges are coveted around the world. They're the best oranges, they say, of any place in the world. And the reason is because these orange trees, the way that they produce the sweetest and the best oranges in the world is through heat, is through droughts. So if you have a drought one year, now the news doesn't tell you this. They sit there and they say it's a calamity and climate is changing and God doesn't know what he's doing, is what I hear. And all this stuff is going on and God just kind of left us with these climate issues. And here we have these oranges that actually produce the best fruit when they're under pressure, when they're under strain, under duress. You guys, that's what God says even about us. That's why redemption is so beautiful. Because on the other side of redemption, we can actually see more beauty. So pain, I know, as we have seen pain, my wife and I, it's created a passion in us to serve these kids over in Africa and these families and to be able to help bring many people together to be able to see Jesus more clearly, and then has provided a purpose for us. How about you? You guys, if redemption truly is what God has done, Jesus said on the cross, his last words were what? It's finished. It's accomplished. It's complete. And we're sitting there freaking out because of the way we're treated here in our own country and that we're not a God-fearing country anymore. And we're freaking out doing all these things, trying to figure out, we're forgetting that Christ, it's finished, it's complete, it's accomplished. My encouragement is to remember that. He says in John 14, 27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives you, do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, let it not be afraid. That's what I want to leave with you guys this morning. And I want to be able to show, we had at this last event, it was at the Museum of Flight in Seattle, we had hundreds of people come to this big gala, red carpet event. Thank the Lord we raised $150,000 plus. And there was a girl that came We met her because she was one of the first girls we met in the hospital. She was dying. Could you go to that slide? Her name is Gifty. And this is her right here. She had liver failure. And our staff, our employees over there, it was the first, what we call the dream team. It was the first group of young professionals from Mercy Ships, actually, that I asked to come help us. And we found this little girl suffering and dying. We didn't know what to do. We had $3,000 in the bank with Orphan Relief and Rescue. And we had seven people over there trying to work with the government and work all these things, and it was crazy. Go to the next slide. And I remember meeting her, and yes, she looks terrified. I terrify my granddaughters until about age one, and then after that, I'm the best thing ever to them. But holding her and seeing this, I wanted to show just a small clip, because you guys, this is the best. She came to share with everyone. Thank you. She's here in the United States. She had a liver surgery. A young family was able to adopt her. We don't usually do adoptions, but when it comes to emergency rescues, we will. We'll work with the governments to do that. And this little girl was able to share in front of hundreds her dreams of becoming a designer and some of the things. She did have a severe stroke afterwards. Her mind is very clear, but she could hardly speak. She has a hard time speaking, but she speaks. It doesn't matter. That's not holding her back. And the other thing is that she has to use a walker, but she walked up on stage on her own just to be able to share. And so anyway, I'm just going to show you just this little video of where she's at now. That was from the movie Annie, the latest rendition. And I will tell you that this is the best way to explain redemption. All the young people you saw in that video, we met them, and they were our employees, and all of them had questions in their faith. Sorry. That little girl, not only is her life saved, all these young people are now serving Jesus Christ. Some of them, one guy works at Yale University, working with international studies and doing amazing things. They're having families. They're sharing with their families about Jesus. See, you guys, that's redemption. If we accept who Jesus is and accept that it is finished, then you guys, I don't care about who's president. I don't care what the politics. Jesus isn't freaked out. God's not freaked out. And if you are, then there's a lack of faith happening within you. And so my encouragement is, Weiser Community Church, rise up and be the very essence of the Almighty. Meaning that the Almighty's hands are often found at the end of our arms. That's all that Jesus asks of you, is to be his hands and feet in this Weiser community and to see people come to know Jesus Christ. Amen? Thank you.
We're going to go straight into worship. Thank you, Tim, for sharing with us. I think you really touched all of us here, and I hope that many are inspired and at very minimal take the opportunity to add Orphan Relief and Rescue to your prayer list so that you can lift them up in prayer every morning and perhaps feel inspired also to help support them financially, as there are certainly many, many, many expenses involved with their ministry. So please be prayerfully considering that. We're going to move into communion here shortly, and our worship is going to surround the concept of communion. And as Tim was speaking about redemption, we're reminded that the redemption would never happen without Christ's sacrifice on the cross. And the Last Supper was instituted as a reminder to us not only of his sacrifice, but the redemption that is made available to us through it. And so if you're willing, let's go ahead and stand together. And will you hit the lights for us, please, Steve? Thank you.
I kneel and see the measure of my sin, how you became a curse for me, though you were innocent. The magnitude of your great love was shown in full degree righteous blood, the crimson spill, rained down from Calvary. Oh, the precious blood that flowed from mercy's side washed away my sin when Christ my Savior died. Oh, the precious blood the crucified. He speaks to me before your throne, where I stand justified. And who am I that I should know the treasure of such worth? My Savior's pure atoning blood shed for the wrath I'd earned. For sin had stained my every deed, my every word and thought. What wondrous love that makes me one, your priceless blood has bought. Oh, the precious blood that flowed from mercy's side washed away my sin when Christ my Savior died. Oh, the precious blood of Christ the crucified. He speaks to me before your throne, where I stand justified. Crown of thorns pierced hands and feet, a body bruised and mercy's plea. A crown of thorns pierced hands and feet, a body bruised and mercy's plea. Oh, the precious blood that flowed from mercy's side washed away my sin when Christ my Savior died. Oh, the precious blood of Christ the crucified. He speaks to me before your throne, where I stand justified. He speaks to me before your throne, where I stand justified. Sorrows, Lamb of God, by His own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as He stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, He took a crown of thorns. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where Your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto Thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed Him to that tree. And all that cross, my salvation, where Your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto Thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where Your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto The stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised. He's risen from the grave. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, alleluia, praise and honor unto thee. Now my soul cries out, alleluia, praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee.
You may be seated.
Remain standing and we'll close.
All right. Well, that's loud. Here we go. I often wonder how many of us build our beliefs on something that crumbles. And when that does crumble, whatever it be, it leaves us very confused and leaves us very depressed and very upset. And that's why Jesus said, calls the wise man to build his house upon the rock. And he's calling us to build our faith on the rock, which, of course, is who? It's Jesus. So let us sing together as we sing about our rock.
My rock,
my rock,
my shield, my Jesus, he is real. I can feel deep within my soul. One day he saved my soul and he made me free and whole. My Lord, he is real. So one night I repented and I got down on my bended knee. I cried, Lord, have mercy. Won't you save my soul from sin? Now I'm walking, but not alone. And I'm headed straight for home. My Lord, he is real. I can feel him in my soul. My rock,
my rock,
my shield, my Jesus, he is real. I can feel deep within my soul. Oh, 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 one day he saved my soul and he made me free and whole. My Lord, he is real. To Jesus and repent and get your feet on the solid rock. He's the one who can help you. He will hear you when you cry. Yes, it's Jesus. He's my Savior. He's my friend and my faithful guide. My Lord, he is real. I can feel it in my soul. My rock,
my
shield, my Jesus, he is real. I can feel deep within.
Amen.
Ha, 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 ha.